What is the hot gossip? Tell me everything. What are you guys listening to?
It's the Cooper and Anthony Show.
All right, I got a rock music quiz for you today.
Okay.
Okay. This one's hard. Like, this is going to test your knowledge of rock and roll music. And when we say rock and roll, like, rock and roll, every aspect of rock and roll, like historical stuff from the 60s and 70s right into the 90s. I'm not going to go too current because, you know, there's some great trivia, but, we'll spend all night doing this. So I have a rock music quiz for you that is going to test your knowledge.
I'll get them all right.
Let's say the past couple of decades.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Okay.
All right. We all know that Axl Rose's real name is William Bailey, right? Where did he get the name Axl Rose? I've got three choices for you. Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Axl Rose came from the fact that he's a distant relative of JFK's mother, Rose Kennedy, and it's an homage to her, the name Rose.
Mm-hmm.
B, the name Axl Rose is an anagram of the words oral sex.
Mm-hmm.
Or three, C, since Axl on a car is also called a rod or a shaft, he liked the idea of his name somehow meaning penis.
It's A.
He's a distant relative of JFK's mother, Rose Kennedy.
Yep.
And it's an homage to her.
Yep.
Wrong.
What Axl is it?
Axl Rose is an anagram of the words oral sex.
He's not that smart. I don't believe that one, but okay.
Yeah, no, that is true. It's kind of clever. Okay, who had the most Rolling Stone album covers? Was it Michael Jackson, the Beatles, or Madonna?
Rolling Stone album covers. I will
don't
go
Google it.
I'm not Googling. Here's my hands. Hands are right here.
Hands up.
Madonna.
Interesting. Now, I would have said Madonna. Madonna has the most Rolling Stone album covers by a woman.
Mm-hmm.
So she has 20 on her own. It's the Beatles. The Beatles had 30. But I feel like it's a little sketchy because I'm not sure whether they're counting the Beatles just as a band alone, because John Lennon, as you know, was on the very first cover. Paul McCartney has had solo covers. He had a cover as Wings.
Yeah, so you can't do that. You have to say the Beatles is a band. If you say the Beatles is a band, Madonna would be number one.
Michael Jackson was the youngest at 11 years old.
Mm-hmm.
So he also, I had all those three on the list because they all did make some history.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, question number three of your rock quiz. This one's a two-parter, okay? I have some music here for you. I'm going to play you the song Wild Thing. And then the song Angel of the Morning. I want you to listen to both very carefully. Famous song. Everybody knows this.
Wild Thing.
Yeah?
You make my heart sing.
Right, you know this song, right?
Okay.
Yeah, super famous.
I know that one.
There you go.
Just touch my cheek before you leave.
She had a lot of hair.
Baby.
A whole lot of hair.
Okay, so those two songs, Wild Thing and Angel of the Morning, what did they have in common?
Kenny Rogers wrote both.
I'm going to give you half credit for that, because they did have the same writer, but it wasn't Kenny Rogers. It was a famous singer-songwriter named Chip Taylor.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the first part. The first part is they were written by the same dude. His name was Chip Taylor. Here's part two. Chip Taylor is related to somebody in this famous trio. Which one was he related to? Was it Angelina Jolie, Brad Pitt, or Jennifer Aniston?
It's got to be Angelina Jolie because she's the famous family person.
Well, Jennifer Aniston is too, because her father was a famous actor as well.
He was a soap actor.
Yeah, that's true. That's true. You are correct. It was Angelina Jolie. Mm-hmm. Chip Taylor's real name is James Wesley Voight. He's John Voight's brother.
Uh-huh. So I almost got it right.
Yeah, that's good. Impressive. Okay, question number four. Of these iconic albums of the 1990s, okay, we've got Smashing Pumpkins' Siamese Dream, very famous.
Mm-hmm.
Nirvana's Nevermind.
Mm-hmm.
Green Day Dookie.
Mm-hmm.
And Pearl Jam 10. which band, the entire band, was thrown out of their own album release party?
Oh, that had to be Green Day.
That's what I said when I first thought of it, because I was like, yeah, those guys were trying so hard to be edgy.
And punk. Cool and
yeah, and punk and all that. No, it was Nirvana.
Really?
Yep, Nirvana was kicked out of their own album release party because they started a food fight and they wouldn't stop.
See, I can't picture Dave Grohl doing that. I can picture Kirk doing that, but not Dave.
Remember, it's one of those things where, cause when you look back at the history of Nirvana, I mean, I don't know how much you've read about them, but I've read everybody's biography at this point, and then books about Nirvana and Kurt Cobain. It seems like Kurt Cobain was such the genuine article that Novoselic was trying really hard to be just like him, do whatever he said. He was just sort of like a Kurt wannabe. Mm-hmm. And then remember, Dave Grohl was really young when he was a drummer. So he was just, you know, he was just so happy to be there and be this rock star drummer guy that he just did what the guys did. Like, I guess this is what rock stars do.
Yeah, so, but it was his second real band. So he'd been through that before. So I figure he'd be the only one that would have a straight head on his shoulders.
Yeah.
So that's why we went with Green Day.
Apparently not. No.
No. Food fight. There you go.
Food fight. Yep. Food fight. Okay. What is Billy Joel's Only the Good Die Young really about? You've got three options. It's an homage to his favorite actor, James Dean.
No.
It's a man's attempt to convince a Catholic girl to lose her virginity to him.
No.
Or it's an inspiring song for his friend Rod Stewart, who told him he was afraid he'd be part of the 27 Club because he was partying too much.
And he was afraid for him because he rode a motorcycle.
Right. Oh, Rod Stewart did.
Yeah. So Rod Stewart was afraid for Billy Joel because he rode a bike. And that's one line in the song, riding a bike in the rain. So I will say C.
It is B, a man's attempt to convince a Catholic girl to lose her virginity to him.
Really?
Come out, Virginia. Yeah, don't make me wait. Catholic girls start much too late. Think about the lyrics.
Well, I know that,
sooner or later it comes down to fate. I might as well be the one.
Oh, guys always trying to get laid. That's what it comes to. That's what every song is about. Every song ever written is about a guy trying to get laid or a car. One of the two. There's nothing special about any song. Break it down. It's about a car or a chick.
Right. That's so true. You know, basically every answer to every one of these rock questions I'm going to tell you is pretty much, is the guy going to get laid? That's the answer.
Except for the Nirvana food fight. That was not about getting laid, but all the other ones. I'm sucking pretty bad at this game.
Well, I got the questions particularly hard, specifically because I know you're really good at this sort of thing. Mm. And I went down some questions that I know that you knew, stuff that we've discussed before on the show, or artists that you worked with at Atlantic. So I tried to keep it to stuff that was like so remote and out there that even you wouldn't know.
Okay.
So this is one of those.
Keep it coming.
Like, yeah. Remember in 2012 when Paul McCartney performed at the London Olympics opening ceremony and all the kids were tweeting, who's this old guy?
Mm-hmm.
Remember all that? Like he was performing and it was exciting for people who knew who he was, who heard of the Beatles. So during the London Olympics opening ceremony, the question is, how much did he get paid for that gig? You've got three choices. $1 million, which he immediately donated to charity.
Mm-hmm.
$1 or $1,970 because 1970 was the year the Beatles split up and he thought that would be funny.
A dollar.
You're right.
Yeah, he had to get paid something, but what do you get a guy, a billionaire for Christmas? He's already got enough money. You got to give him more money to play a gig. He doesn't need it.
You know, speaking of Paul McCartney, did you see today he was interviewed in, I think it was the New Yorker or something. The New Yorker at Vanity Fair did a big interview with him.
Mm.
And they asked him about his, I mean, I guess it wasn't really a rivalry with the Rolling Stones, but I guess a little bit because they were making hits at the same time. And he said, you know, I shouldn't really say this, but after all this time, I got to get this off my chest. He said the Rolling Stones were basically a blues cover band.
And they are. They're a blues version of the Beatles.
Right. Yeah, I think Rolling Stone fans would disagree with you vehemently.
No, I think Rolling Stone fans would agree with me 100% because that's what the Rolling Stones called themselves. They said, we came out, we were a blues version of the Beatles. More blues-based than the Beatles were.
I think blues is not the word people are offended by. I think it's the cover band part that people are like,
yeah,
hi, we're
I don't
Rolling
know about
Stones.
The cover band part.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. That's the part that's
maybe a tribute
yet.
Band. We'll go
that's
with that.
Even more insulting. Like, that's even worse. Okay, question number 7. Alanis Morissette, You Ought to Know, won 3 Grammys, and it topped charts all over the world, okay? But here's something you might not know about that song. There was an unexpected bass player who played on that song.
Oh, I know.
Oh, you already know who it is?
Flea.
Oh, I love that you knew that.
And Dave Navarro played guitar.
And Dave Navarro.
I know Flea trivia. I'm a Flea fan. So.
Right. I had some good, I was going to say either Flea from the Red Hot Chili Peppers, Chris Novoselic from Nirvana, or it was the last single The Who's John Entwistle played on before he died in 2002.
No.
But yeah, no, I didn't even need to. Okay, fine. I got 2 more for you. No, 3 more for you.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, this is an audio question. I'm going to play you 3 well-known songs. One of these artists broke several microphones with their voice while recording the songs that I'm about to play for you. Who was it?
Such a great song.
Love this. It's such a great song. So that's Layne Staley from Alice in Chains. That's number 1. 2. Yellow Ledbetter. This is Eddie Vedder from Pearl Jam.
All right. And
finally,
the last one is...
Chris Cornell.
Such a great song.
All great songs, yeah.
On a side note, which video has the most views out of those 3?
I would think at this point it's got to be Chris Cornell because after he died, I'm sure people rediscovered him and just watched his videos like crazy.
Actually, no. Man in a Box. 120 million views. Soundgarden,
whoa,
only 51 million.
Wow. Well, still a lot, but yeah, I didn't realize. Okay.
But Fell on Black Days wasn't their biggest hit. So,
right. That's a good point.
Man in the Box was. I'm going to go with Eddie Vedder. And the reason why I'm going to go with him destroying a mic is he's a mic guy.
Mm-hmm.
He's kind of like me. He's really into mics.
Mm-hmm.
And he cares for mics, and I don't know. I'm just going with Eddie.
It was Chris Cornell. He destroyed so many microphones with his voice, not like Pete Townsend, where he took the microphone and whipped it around or threw it around, or like Roger Daltrey used to do and destroyed it on purpose. No, they were recording. Yeah, they were recording this album.
He kept breaking mics.
Yeah. Yeah, this is Fell on Black Days. Such a great.
I wonder what kind of mic he kept breaking.
So when he was recording Super Unknown, they could not keep microphones. He just kept breaking them, I guess, because his voice, the way he sings, is just, you know, that like either it's the notes that he hits or that really high voice that he has. But yeah, he would blow out the mics over and over.
Oh, God, that has to piss off sound people.
Yeah, <It's>
gotta,
I'm sure.
It's got to drive them crazy.
Okay, so which one of these songs over 8 minutes was the only one to make the top 10 Billboard chart? Top 10. Okay. Was it November Rain at 8 minutes and 57 seconds? Was it American Pie at 8 minutes and 42 seconds? Or was it Purple Rain at 8 minutes and 41 seconds?
Purple Rain, take that out. So it's down to American Pie and November Rain. It's got to be American Pie.
It was November Rain.
Yeah. It can't be Purple Rain because Purple Rain was never a radio hit.
Yeah, that's true.
So yeah, I can't stand that November Rain.
Yeah, a lot of people, even Guns N' Roses fans are like, that's not one of my favorites.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right, here's your final question in the rock music quiz.
Okay.
This is a little less rock music, but it's in our genre. The song Gangsta's Paradise sampled and used some of Stevie Wonder's song Pastime Paradise.
Mm-hmm.
But the song also has something super unique about it. Here are your choices. Is this the song that gave Coolio his first Grammy? Is it one of the only rap songs with no curse words in it at all? Or is it a main soundtrack for three big movies spanning several decades, Dangerous Minds, Pain and Gain, and even 2020 Sonic the Hedgehog?
Yeah, it's going to be that one.
It's all three.
Oh, really?
Yeah, all three of these are true. This is the song that gave Coolio his first Grammy.
Mm-hmm.
This Gangsta's Paradise has no curse words in it at all because Stevie Wonder insisted on it. He said, if you're going to use anything from Pastime Paradise, he's featured in it, all that kind of stuff. He's like, no cursing.
Mm-hmm.
So Coolio said, you know what? I get to work with Stevie Wonder. And this song I feel strongly about took all the curse words out.
Wow. Did not know that. And it was in three movies.
Spanning decades. That's what's so interesting. I mean, Dangerous Minds, that's the Michelle Pfeiffer movie from a million years ago. So,
all right. Now you have trivia for me. I have trivia for you.
Ooh.
And this is female artist trivia.
Okay.
Let's see how good you are. And I don't think you'll get this right.
I doubt I will. I'm not as good as you are with trivia. Go ahead.
No, this is pop female trivia. So you're pretty good about that. Who is the most played female artist in the UK this century?
This century?
Yeah, this is the UK this century. Who's the most played female artist?
Adele.
Adele would be not right. She is number 6.
Oh, huh. In the UK, is it somebody who is American?
I'm not telling you. You have to guess. I'll tell you. Number 20 is Ariana Grande.
Okay.
And then Diana Ross is 17.
No way, yeah. Diana Ross! You're kidding me.
Christina Aguilera 16. Dua Lipa is 14. Kelly Clarkson is 13. Taylor Swift is 11. Number 10 is Whitney Houston.
Okay.
Little Mix is 9.
Okay.
Kylie Minogue is 8. Then who else is left in the top 7?
Pink.
Did you look that up?
No.
You looked it up.
Nope. No, as a matter of fact, Pink, when she went on tour, I remember the UK tour was a really big deal there. I mean, she's huge there. First, I was going to say Lady Gaga, but then I remembered they love her in the UK, obviously, but not as much. We love her here more. And then I remembered as you were talking, as you were reading the list, and I realized you didn't say Pink.
Mm-hmm.
I know that Pink's tour there broke records.
Yeah. So number 7 is Beyonce.
Wow.
Number 6 is Adele. Number 5 is Lady Gaga.
Hmm.
Then you have number 4, Rihanna. Number 3 is Katy Perry, 2 Madonna, and number 1, yeah, you're right, Pink. Number 1 most played female artist in the UK this century.
I thought that Adele was going to be number 1 and Pink was number 2. That would have been my guess if you would have asked me straight up, like, who do you think is number 1 and 2 and in what order? That's what I would have said. But when you told me Adele was not there, I was like, well, now you just gave me the answer.
Yeah, Adele and Little Mix are the only two homegrown artists in the top 10.
Wow.
So everybody else is American.
The Cooper and Anthony Show.
At what age should you retire if you're a rock star? Is there an age?
No, I don't think there's an age. I think there's a moment. There's the moment that you show up at a tour on a tour and you realize the tickets are not being sold. Like, people are not coming anymore. Like, it's, you know, it's that moment you say to yourself, ah, you know, my moment is over. Mm. I like the idea of leaving when you're at the top rather than waiting until people have forgotten about you. But yeah, I think it depends is the answer. You know, there's plenty of people that, you know, like Tiffany, you know, she had that one song, it didn't go anywhere. So she retired at like 22. Yeah. I mean, everyone has their different, but then there's, you know, like Dave Grohl, we were just talking about him. He's in his 50s. He is still rocking hard. That tour is sold out everywhere.
But you look at somebody like Charlie Watts, who played right up until he died.
Exactly.
I mean, he had no retirement.
What age? I mean, the Rolling Stones are on tour right now. So the answer is age is not the factor that makes you decide.
And when I looked at Rolling Stones tickets, they were 10 grand a piece.
Wow, what?
10 grand.
Who could afford that?
It was sold out. I mean,
it's amazing.
You're never going to see him again. That's the thing. You know, if you see him now, that's going to be the last tour.
Yeah, but who has 10 grand sitting around for just one experience? I mean, 10 grand to have sex. Well, who wants to have sex with them at this point? But I'm just saying, like, I would need more for my 10 grand than just a seat. A seat where I'm short, everyone around me is too tall, and they're going to sing along. So I'm not really going to hear the band. I'm going to hear, you know, the accountant next to me. Like, that's not worth 10 grand.
But I have a buddy, Scott, who went to the show and live streamed the whole thing. So I saved myself 10 grand and I watched it at home. And it was about the same experience.
Right. I was going to say, go to YouTube. It's all there for free.
And you know what? I didn't catch COVID.
Right.
I was fine. I was home and my beer is much cheaper here. So Gene Simmons, the band Kiss, they've been on the road now forever. This tour is going to be the last tour they do. It's the end tour, but that's not going to happen because Gene's going to run out of money at some point and go back on the road. But Gene has caught COVID on this tour. Paul has caught COVID on this tour. So last night they were in Florida, I think. So this is the opening song, and you got to look at Gene and go, dude, how old are you?
Right.
And you're still putting on that makeup and you're living it. And we've had Gene on the show, so we can talk shit about him, but you're still putting the makeup on and going on the stage and now falling from the sky. You're still doing this at age 114.
You're 72.
He's 72. So here they come. Here comes Kiss.
Okay,
out of the sky.
Right.
On these platforms.
They're being lowered down with all the makeup on.
Living it. There's the pyro. Oh, there goes Gene. He's getting ready to fall.
Okay, so the stage, the floating stage like Kanye had.
Now they're blowing fire at him.
he's in the big giant shoes.
This does not look good because he could break a hip. This is the problem right here.
They have to make a showman out of it. They've got to listen. I have seen a lot of these older artists and they don't move around on the stage like they used to. So you got to do something for the audience that makes it seem like you're doing a show, like they're being lowered. And then they just can stand there and play after that. You know, you've made your big entrance.
Mm-hmm.
So I think the beauty of all of that makeup, it's so funny. You would think like when they were in their 20s and decided to do it with the makeup, it probably never occurred to them that they'd be in their 70s still putting that fucking makeup on.
Still today doing the makeup. Stop it with the makeup.
After all this time. Yeah. But look, the audience is still there. They still have the fan base. That's what I'm saying. So they're not too old because the fans are there.
Yeah. And I went to a Kiss show a couple of years ago, so I'm one of those people. You know, you dragged me into it.
How was it?
It was freaking awesome. I mean, they're great. I love them.
Right.
But he doesn't need to be falling from the sky. That's the problem. Yeah. You know, just walk out on the stage in your 75-inch heels. You don't need to fall, ascend from the ceiling if you're Gene Simmons. I mean, he's still blowing fire. They still have photos of him blowing fire from a sword, even today. Wow.
It's impressive at 72. It's impressive at 52, let alone 72. I think that's amazing. You know, more power to him. And, you know, speaking of rock star retirement, did you hear about Smash Mouth today?
Oh, what happened to Smash Mouth?
Oh, okay. So this is kind of interesting. Let me explain the story first before we play the audio from it, because it's really out there. So if you don't understand what's going on, you're not gonna get it from listening to this audio. So Smash Mouth's lead singer, Steve Harwell, announced today that he's retiring. He's 54. He's retiring, but it's after this incident. So they're doing a show in upstate New York. It goes totally off the rails. So this girl at the show posted this TikTok about it, but here's what you're going to see. He doesn't seem to know where he is.
Oh, no.
He's belligerent. He's slurring his words, and then he starts yelling at the audience and giving them the finger, like, almost like he doesn't have Alzheimer's, but it's almost like somebody with Alzheimer's who suddenly like realizes that there's people around them and, you know, fuck all of you assholes, that kind of thing. So let's play the clip so people can at least hear it.
Yeah, he likes his alcohol.
Okay, I know the ethics of this aren't great, but I did just see Smash Mouth perform live at a local beer and wine festival. When I say this is the most chaotic show I've ever seen in my entire life.
Unintelligible speech.
Yeah, he's singing. We don't know what he's singing. He's just like,
Oh, there's nothing but feedback nonstop. Oh,
right.
Oh, that's...
He's wandering around the stage aimlessly.
Flipping people off.
Yeah, they're trying to play, hey, now you're a rock star.
Hey, now you were a rock star.
Yeah, these aren't even lyrics.
I'm going to effing kill your whole family.
Yeah, he's yelling at the audience. I'm going to fucking kill your whole
family.
Quiet
now. I'm the singer. Quiet.
So they finally like pull him off stage like a cartoon character, like with a hook. They pull him off stage and some girl in the audience, she's like, it's my birthday. And they're like, come on up here.
Oh, no.
So some rando chick gets up on stage and starts singing like, you know, happy birthday to me. Hey, now you're a rock star. And she's like singing the song and they're playing. The rest of the band is just like, sure. This chick is our new lead singer. Not a problem. We're good. We're good with some rando. So the band is saying that he has a ton of health issues, which include physical stuff like cardiomyopathy. But they say he also has some mental health issues, which seems pretty clear watching this. Mm-hmm. And all of these are remnants over the years of drug and alcohol abuse. But specifically drug abuse. I know you said, you know, that you've seen him.
I know that he drinks, and he was drinking 20 years ago. And when I say drink, I don't mean hanging out with your friends, couple of beers before you go on stage. I'm talking about chugging Jim Beam before you go on stage.
Wow.
So
let me ask you a question about that. So we have stuff like, you know, the mixtape tour is coming up with New Kids on the Block, Rick Astley, Salt-N-Pepa, and Vogue. And then there's the Sugar Ray Cruise. Mm-hmm. You know, you can go on. It's like Sugar Ray and a bunch of 90s pop bands that, you know, every time it's somebody different that just shows up or whatever. I feel badly for these artists because they were once really famous, really well known. They had their moment and they still have a fan base. It's not as big as it was, but they still do have a fan base, you know. But I don't know that they're all physically or mentally, you know, we're comparing this to Kiss and the Rolling Stones. That's a whole different category. Mm-hmm. Those guys are ageless. Their fans are still passionate. The older fans have taught their kids about Kiss. So when you go to a Kiss show, there's kids there who are 13 with their, you know, 50, 60 something year old fathers. That's a whole different category. Mm-hmm. I'm talking about the bands that
Smash Mouth,
like the Smash Mouths of, the people like that, that, you know, they had a moment and it's over, but yet they still I mean, what are they supposed to do? Go sell cars? Like, what else would you do for a living? I just feel bad for them.
Yeah, you kind of have to. I mean, nowadays, what do you do? It's like radio. I mean, radio really doesn't exist the way it used to be. So you got to figure out a way to fit into it. So that's what Mark McGrath is doing. He's trying to figure out how to fit in this world being Mark McGrath.
Right.
You know, and that's the bad thing is you're walking down the mall and somebody goes, isn't that Sugar Ray?
Right. You know, isn't right. That?
And yeah, he is, but he isn't. So that's the bad thing about Smash Mouth. Smash Mouth is only known for songs in Shrek. That's pretty right. much all they're known for anymore.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah. Yeah, so, and the guy, I'm telling you, complete drunk. And this is 20 years ago. So I can imagine how bad it is now.
But I feel bad for these bands that really had, they were the precursors. Like if you look like Danity Kane, you know, Pussycat Dolls, that kind mm-hmm. of thing. Those are bands that are like precursors to, you know, Fifth Harmony. You know, what happened to those girls? Where are the Cheetah Girls? Where's Girls Aloud and 98 Degrees? And, you know, there were so many of those bands, S Club 7, O-Town. You know what I mean? There was a moment that we were like, oh my God, O-Town's awesome. We watched the reality show, you know, of them becoming O-Town, LFO, mm-hmm. you know, all those bands. And they had their moment and then it was just over. But like fast, over fast. And I feel badly for them because they either, you know, they messed it up on their own or their label messed it up or they didn't have a follow-up single, you know, but then what do you do with your life after that?
Yeah, there was a guy in a hair band back in the day, and the hair band has continued to go on now, but without this bass player. And mm-hmm. I was sitting there the other day going, I wonder whatever happened to him, because I knew him and we used to hang out, but I haven't heard from him in forever. So I looked him up and he's in Kingsport, Tennessee, and he's a massage therapist.
Right.
So right. You're getting a massage.
What else is he going to do?
You're getting a massage and you look up, you go, aren't you the bass player in that band?
I know that. That's, it must be really hard. You know, a lot of these bands, when they become so famous and then it's just over. I mean, I think about the rest of NSYNC. You know, I mean, Justin Timberlake is Justin Timberlake. Mm-hmm. But, you know, poor Lance Bass is still trying to drag it out. You know, Mary's like got his moment here and there and he's trying. He's trying. But, you know, they don't have the career that, you know, one guy ends up having. But like, what about the rest of Sugar Ray? Like, okay, you said Mark McGrath. What about the rest of those guys?
Yeah, you don't know who they are. But it's like you're getting a massage from the bass player for Whitesnake, and Whitesnake is still right. on the road.
Right.
And they're yeah. still making commercials and having kind of a success. But the bass player is massaging your back.
Is that DePrume?
No, it's not even Whitesnake. It's a different band.
Oh, okay. All right.
But, you know, he got out of music in Kingsport, Tennessee, giving massages.
Right. Well, you know what? I'm sure he's much happier. I'm sure it's a less stressful life.
Because it sucked being in that band and getting laid.
It sucks being a rock star.
Yeah, poor guy was getting laid every single night in a different city, opening for Aerosmith and having all the free drugs and alcohol.
Dreadful.
And, yeah, it was horrible. So he's living a much happier life now. He goes home to his cat in Kingsport, Tennessee.
What are you two doing here?
It's the Cooper and Anthony Show.
Now, there are certain things that people do not believe, and I found out today, I was shocked, because we started talking about, we have a meeting every day to discuss what we're going to be talking about in the show, and Chad and I were talking about this list of, you know, some myths about dinosaurs that we were, you know, we found.
And we have Anthony, very exciting conversations.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hey, did you hear about the dinosaur myths?
Well, no, that's kind of how it started. I think it's very interesting. Things that you would think about dinosaurs are absolutely untrue. And we were trying to figure out how we can work this in because it was interesting stuff. And Anthony said that his wife... And were you kidding? Or your wife really does not believe dinosaurs existed?
No, she doesn't believe it at all. She believes that there was no dinosaurs.
Even though there's skeletons of them.
There's huge skeletons in every museum in the country.
Right.
You can see them.
Is that a government conspiracy? Or?
Yes.
Okay.
Has she been to a museum? Has she ever been to a museum and seen
There's
dinosaur
one
bones?
By our house with a big T-Rex.
And when
right
she went
when
there
you walk
to see
in the door.
It. Okay. When she went there to see it, she said
that it's plastic. Which it is. It's not the real bones of the T-Rex. It's a plastic recreation of the dinosaur.
But there are places that you can go. There are natural history museums all over the country where you can actually see.
You cannot convince her.
So what does she think those are? Like, what does she
just bones that somebody put together?
And said that there were dinosaurs. Like, I don't sense it's not like it's a fringe group of people who are saying dinosaurs. I mean, it's like saying gravity doesn't exist.
Right.
Or if you're like that woman on The View, the Earth is flat.
Right. Exactly. Yeah. Thank you, Chad.
Even though we could, you know, show you a picture from the space shuttle.
Right.
And it's not flat.
Well, we'll see a TV show of dinosaurs, and they'll be talking about dinosaurs. I don't believe it. What do you mean you don't believe it? It's right there. There was
a famous baseball player that was the same way. In an interview, he said he didn't believe in dinosaurs either.
Now, wait a minute. What kind of interview with a baseball player?
Well, this guy was a whack job.
But how do you talk
these,
about baseball and come up with
all
dinosaurs?
All these bizarre topics would come up in these interviews.
Same way
with this
we
guy.
Talk about this show and we come up talking about dinosaurs.
For some reason, it came up and he said, I don't believe in dinosaurs.
So people that don't believe in dinosaurs, what do they believe instead? That they just didn't exist and people made it up?
Yes,
or?
That it's all made up. It's like you. You don't believe in UFOs, the Loch Ness Monster. You don't believe in Bigfoot.
I don't believe in Bigfoot. That's true. Or the Loch Ness Monster, right.
Yeah, if Bigfoot came... There's new photos 2 days ago of Bigfoot on the internet. But you won't believe it.
Because those are photos that could be doctored and photoshopped.
Same thing about the bones in a dinosaur.
Okay, so she thinks that all that stuff is just...
It's just rock.
Well, let me tell you some of the myths about dinosaurs. Because I gotta say, I believe dinosaurs existed, but as I'm reading through these myths, I maybe don't believe it so much anymore. I may be with Mrs. Anthony. Because some of the way they explain this, it doesn't... Like, for example, so why did they disappear?
Exactly.
And the answer is nobody really knows why they disappeared.
Mm-hmm.
And the myth is, like one of the myths in here, is that it was a big asteroid that came. Well, it's true that the asteroid came and probably killed a lot of dinosaurs in the path of where the... not that kind of asteroid, Anthony. Have fun playing that, though.
Okay.
The myth about the dinosaurs' disappearance... Let me try and find that one, because that one was really actually interesting.
Mm-hmm.
That basically where the impact was pretty much where Mexico's Yucatan Peninsula is. That's how big.
Right.
So, but that would only kill the dinosaurs within that... See, an asteroid impact alone killed the dinosaurs, and what they're saying, that's the myth. It's not true that a layer of iridium-rich rock marks the impact 65 million years ago of a 10-kilometer asteroid in shallow water covering what is now Mexico's Yucatan Peninsula. So they're saying that there's no convincing evidence that that's all that killed the dinosaurs. They think it contributed to it somehow.
Mm.
But the fact that they don't really know.
You know what this sounds like, Chad? Science!
Science! It is science. But it makes me think, like, so... But there's a lot of stuff that people believe, no matter how much evidence there is. Well,
Anthony's
or
like
don't
that.
Believe.
What?
When it comes to the moon landing?
Yeah, that was not... That did not happen yet.
So you don't think that we landed on the moon? You think that's fictitious?
No, we still haven't been there.
Even though we've have interviews with astronauts and actual moon rocks and Tang... You still don't believe we're on the moon.
Why do you think they made Tang, Anthony? What do you think Tang was for?
They can't make a dodge where the bumper doesn't fall off. But you're telling me we sent people to the moon and then brought them back.
Right.
Go to
in
aisle
1960.
Nine. Go to aisle 9 at Food Lion and look at the Tang.
In the 60s, cars didn't last to 35,000 miles, but they made a rocket ship go to the moon.
So you don't believe that we
So even
the
though
moon.
There's a plethora of scientific evidence, you still don't believe it.
When's the last time you saw a 1960 car still driving?
I see classic cars all the time.
I know.
But they've been fixed up.
Well,
I'm not the only one. R.E.M. made a song about it.
It's about Andy Kaufman.
Yeah. Not about not going to the moon.
Huh? kind of is.
No, it's really not.
It's really about Andy Kaufman.
No, he talks about the moon.
Right, but not... Right, he talks about the moon because we've landed there.
No, we did not. It's a conspiracy.
Okay, so you really... So you're... This is a very interesting couple, actually. I really should talk to you and your wife together. So your wife doesn't believe in dinosaurs, and you don't believe that we landed on the moon.
And their house is actually covered in aluminum foil.
That's why we've never been there,
Chad. Not stick aluminum
foil. They're too embarrassed to have us there. Okay, so what do you not believe, no matter how
much
evidence...
See, here he goes. If you believe they put a man
on the moon, man on the moon. Oh, because he's saying, if you believe.
Right.
Meaning that he might be skeptical about it.
Yeah, Michael doesn't believe.
So you think Michael Stipe does not believe we put a man on the moon either?
Exactly.
So you and Michael Stipe.
His head looks like a moon.
Okay, so what do you not believe, no matter how much evidence there is? No matter how much people try to convince you, you don't believe it. 877-6-COOPER.
Yeah, we were in a race back then to see who was going to be the first country on the moon.
Mm-hmm.
And we just popped up there one day. Here we are!
One small step for man.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And so, I can't get the lady at the drive-thru to hear me say, Mountain Dew.
Right, Mountain Dew.
But we can talk to dude on the moon.
So let me ask you something then. Wait a minute. Oh, never mind. I can't.
Ask.
No, because you're freaking me out a little, to be honest. So do you believe that no one's been on the moon? Do you believe the Russians didn't put anybody there either, or just us?
No. I don't. We might have gone since, but I don't think the 60s, we weren't anywhere near the moon.
So you think that whole thing in the 60s was just fabricated? Like, people say it was in a studio and
exactly.
They say they have proof.
And they have, you know, the shadows falling one way or another, things like that, yeah. I don't believe there's a flag up there from 1960.
69.
Whatever.
It doesn't matter. Just pick any date because he doesn't believe it anyway, John.
Right,
so it doesn't really matter.
Okay.
They made a Vega in 71, but they can make a space shuttle, or a rocket, go to the moon, land, and then come right back.
But yep.
Anthony, General Motors did not make rockets. NASA did. If NASA made cars, I can see this being your argument. But NASA weren't the ones who made the cars.
Same guys.
General Motors was.
Same guys.
It was. Angela, what's your question about dinosaurs?
Well, I don't really have a question. I just have an observation about the dinosaurs. They can't prove why they are extinct, but yet we have all kinds of proof about other animals that are extinct. I mean, the dodo bird is extinct, and we accept that it's extinct for different environmental reasons, or, you know, their food supply ran out, or whatever the food part of the food chain that they were, they've just been eradicated. So why would that not hold true for a dinosaur as well? The environment just changed for them, or, you know, something on Earth just, you know, it changed and dwindled the supply of dinosaurs.
Well, that's perfectly scientific and rational, and people that believe there's no such thing as dinosaurs aren't scientific and rational.
I also want to let you guys know that I've got a 1960 Corvette sitting in my garage that runs absolutely perfect.
It's not making it to the moon.
We're going to try it tomorrow, though.
But it wasn't made by NASA, Anthony. That's why. It was made by, who made Corvettes
GM.
Back then?
GM.
Well, there you go. It was
Much
made by
smarter
GM.
Smarter than NASA.
There you go. See, that her what she said about the dinosaurs, that was my problem with it also. They don't know how they died off. That's my only thing, because how could they not know that?
I'm going to play all moon songs.
I see that you are. Hey, Tim.
Hey, how are you?
We're good. So, you know, Anthony does not believe that we were on the moon.
And he believes the Earth is flat, too.
God.
Well, you know, I got to tell you, it's pretty moronic to believe we never went to the moon. Does he believe in the space shuttle?
Yes, I've seen it.
Okay, do you believe in the Hubble telescope?
Sure.
Okay, do you believe in the International Space Station?
Sure.
Okay, how did we get to all that technology?
It just appeared.
Magic?
It didn't go up there in 1969, Tim.
My point was just made. How did we get to the technology if we never went to the moon?
Because the technology had the plans to build a Hubble space station up there.
Yeah, it's like arguing with a wall, Tim.
I was going to say, Tim, you see what I deal with every single night.
Make any sense.
No, you don't make any sense.
Because the plans were up there to build
saying,
it.
Tim is saying
there are blueprints
going
on the moon.
Listen, our going to the moon in 1969.
King Harvest.
Compared to what we have now, it was rudimentary what they did back then. And if it wasn't for that, we wouldn't have the technology we have now. We wouldn't have the space shuttle. That's Tim's point.
Dancing in the moonlight.
We have all that stuff now. Oh, Anthony. But Mindy, you agree with Anthony.
I absolutely agree with Anthony. And if you look it up, like, the World Wide Web, the whole thing. That
where everything is true.
Everything's true on the web.
What's his name invented? So,
Al Gore.
Look, if you believe that, then you can believe people landed on the moon in 1969.
It's true.
The guy that bought before that was calling it moronic to believe that people were on the moon, he didn't back anything up. All he did was call you moronic.
Exactly.
That's true.
Thank you, Mindy.
Where is your point? You don't have a point. All you're doing is believing everything that everybody's telling you. You can't do that.
You're like a sheep.
I'm a designer. I design motors. All right? Mm-hmm. The whole concept behind design is to first think it up and then do it. So they thought it up. They stuck people in a black room, gave them some suits. And have you ever noticed that there is the absence of stars in the back of all those pictures?
Mm-hmm. I'm going to go look because I've never noticed that, but I'm going to go look.
They have proven over and over again that those pictures were made in a black room, that they were not made on the moon. There is the total absence of all light in space on those pictures.
Now, Mindy, let me ask you something. Do you believe we've been to the moon since, or that Russians have been to the moon, or do you just believe that we've never been?
I don't believe that anybody has actually stepped foot on the moon, no.
Even Russians?
I believe, yes, because they don't have, I don't believe, the technology to get a human down there and then to bring them back.
Bring them back.
Because they don't have the rocket power. They don't have it to get it there. Look, they blew how many space shuttles up? You think they're going to land something in 1969 on the moon and then bring it back without blowing it up?
Yep. Thank you, Mindy. She makes lots of sense.
Interesting. That's actually a very good argument. Oh, no.
Do you want to hear evidence why all the Apollo?
And you got the evidence off the internet.
No, I've looked it up.
Let me hear, Chad. I want to hear.
A dozen astronauts with cameras walked on the moon between 69 and 72. Nine of them are still alive and can testify to their experience. They brought home 841 pounds of moon rock home to Earth.
They drank Tang.
And a scientist says that moon rocks are absolutely unique. They differ from Earth rocks in many respects, and hundreds of scientists have looked at moon rocks.
Like, scientist means non-partial, people that don't work for NASA. It means people whose job it is to look at stuff and go, no, this is not true. Scientists actually, this is one thing they teach you in grad school. You go out to debunk stuff. You say, I don't believe this to be true. And what you try to do is find something, evidence why it is true. Go there skeptical.
Somebody's going to convince you yet, Cooper. I know you.
No, I'm saying so. my point is the scientists, because people have said, oh, well, those are scientists that are paid by NASA. They're not. That's the whole idea. Mm-hmm. The people that sat and looked at the moon rocks are people that were objective, is
right.
My point. But Karen, you don't think, do you think we've never walked on the moon, or do you think we just didn't do it in 1969?
No, I don't believe that anybody has ever walked on the moon.
Anthony's applauding.
Wow.
Yay, Anthony, because it's ridiculous to think that we went there. If you look at the picture, they say that there's no gravity. Well, then how did they stand on the moon? It's funny that the flag stands straight out, but how did the people actually stand there if there's no gravity?
Because they have weight in their spacesuits.
Gravity. If there's no gravity, there's
no weight.
There's no weight. So
see?
How did they stand on the moon?
Chad, because this is out of my depth.
They had little rockets in their shoes, right, Chad? That kept them there.
Right.
No, that's...
Yeah. Okay, and another thing, when Cooper said, well, what about Tang? And I'm thinking, well, what about Kool-Aid? It's the same thing. It's an invention. Is it just, a product?
But they made Tang for the astronauts.
Okay, they could have made it for him. They made it on Earth. They didn't make it on the moon.
That's my evidence. There's Tang. We had to have been on the moon because Tang exists.
When we got to the moon, there were blueprints and Tang.
Yes, but there's no gravity. So how in the world did they stand on the moon?
You know what, Karen? I don't believe in Kool-Aid.
There was less. I believe there's gravity up there, but I think it was less gravity.
Right, exactly. It's
yeah,
just
there's less gravity than there is.
Right, there's right less
here.
Gravity, and that's. But the suits. So wait a minute. So do you believe they were there or not, Anthony? You believe they just weren't there in 1969, but we've been there since.
And there's a poll. 6% of people believe that the moon landing never happened.
Well, obviously, that 6% listens to this show.
I know. They're all calling. 6% believe this, and they're all listening.
Wow.
Because it has electrolytes.
Okay, what do you not believe, no matter how much evidence there is? Now, Anthony does not believe that we landed on the moon in 1969. Chad, what do you not believe in?
I don't believe in love.
Chad doesn't believe in love.
I never have.
I never will. The Queensryche.
Queensryche song.
Okay, well, good enough. I don't believe in the Loch Ness Monster and Bigfoot.
Mm. I think you're in the majority, though, there. Anthony is definitely in the minority, and his wife is in the super, super minority.
Yeah, Anthony's wife does not believe that they were dinosaurs, ever. And one of the myths about dinosaurs, humans lived alongside dinosaurs, and according to
that
science...
That is
Land of the Lost.
Well, that's the thing. In movies and cartoons and books, that's the only place that they coexisted.
Oh.
Yeah. According to science, the last dinosaurs, other than birds, died out dramatically 65 million years ago, while the fossils of our earliest human ancestors are only about 6 million years old. So there you go.
So next thing you're going to tell me is that Sleestaks didn't exist either.
Sleestaks did exist. I believe in Sleestaks.
Okay.
Absolutely. I've seen no evidence otherwise.
Because they really freaked out Chad when he was a kid.
I know. They were scary.
Now, Brian, one of Anthony's arguments is, you know, there was the Pinto and the Pacer and these horrible cars that blew up, and yet they sent somebody to the moon. That's his argument.
Well, yeah, I feel like that if the car companies made cars that lasted forever, they'd be out of business.
Just like
everybody
the pantyhose
would
people.
The same thing.
Right, just like the pantyhose people.
Yeah, they just drive the same car forever.
Exactly.
Planned obsolescence is a technical term for that.
Planned obsolescence?
Right.
Wow, we learned something new.
Indeed.
I like that. Planned obsolescence means that if you make something that never is destroyed, you'll never have to, you're out of business.
You'll never buy another one.
Correct.
Oh, that's very interesting.
Things are designed to wear out.
Okay, I like that. Hey, James.
Hey.
Now,
how you guys?
Well, we're very good. Now, James, what do you not believe in, no matter how much evidence there is?
Well, I've actually got kind of three things real quick.
Go.
My partner does not believe in ghosts. He says there's a show that I like to watch called A Haunting,
mm-hmm.
and it's on Discovery Channel, and it talks about these families and these people who lived in haunted houses, and they tell their story and stuff. Whenever I have that on, he's sitting there going, oh, turn that crap off. That's just full of malarkey. And, you know, I was like, you don't believe in ghosts? And he says, absolutely not. I think it's just a bunch of malarkey. So,
do you watch Ghost Hunters, James?
I've seen it, yes, and I like it.
It's the best show ever.
Is that because, does he have a scientific mind? Is that why?
I don't know. He just does not believe in ghosts. And
Here's your evidence. Science has said, and this is evidence that scientists have said over and over, you cannot kill energy. Energy doesn't die.
Exactly.
Right? So that's your argument right there, that
right.
if we're energy...
Right. And the funny side of that, his grandmother in 1969, she didn't believe that we landed on the moon, and she was a country mountain woman, and he says she'd sit there and say, why, they're not on the moon, they're somewhere out in Arizona.
See? Smart woman.
Well, Anthony, you said California.
It was
soundstage in Hollywood?
Exactly.
California.
Sure it was.
And the serious thing that I believe... that there is a cure for a lot of real serious diseases like the HIV, AIDS,
mm-hmm.
certain cancers and stuff like that. But the medical people or the professionals out there and the government, you know, it's kind of like that thing you were talking about, building the perfect car.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if they got rid of AIDS or if they got rid of certain cancers or whatever, then they couldn't make money off of it. So
yep.
I think they have a cure. They're just not giving it to us.
That the money that goes into research is lining a lot of people's pockets, so there's
exactly.
no reason for them to. I've heard that before.
Mm-hmm.
Heard people say that before.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting.
They didn't
Thank
go
you,
to
James.
The moon. It was in Arizona.
See?
Arizona. California.
Mm-hmm.
Somewhere out in California. Hey, Daniel.
Hi.
Now, is there something that you do not believe, no matter how much evidence there is?
I don't think we went to the moon.
You don't think we've ever been, or that we didn't go in 1969?
I don't think we've ever been.
Do you believe that no one's ever been, that the Russians have never been?
Well, from the research that I've done, according to NASA themselves, they've tried, prior to going to the moon the first time, the United States attempted practice landings here mm-hmm. on Earth with their space shuttle, and out of the five times they tried, they failed five times. But they said, you know what, that's good enough, let's go and try it anyway, and they were supposedly successful. And then with the weightlessness on the moon, I don't believe, how can they be that weightless when the moon's gravity shifts the tides in the ocean?
Hmm.
And also, they, prior to going up there, they didn't realize that there was two radiation belts and how wide they were, and they had to go through that going and then coming back. So they were exposed to high doses of radiation, the Van Allen radiation belts, a total of four times.
Right, and so you would think if they were exposed to that level of radiation,
they would have been glowing.
Right, and when they came back, about, I think it was 3 to 4 years later, they did more research and found out how actually much radiation there was. And still to this day, astronauts that to get too close to it without even going through them get burned and come back down here and die early because of radiation.
See?
It's evidence for Anthony.
6% of the people don't believe that we didn't land on the moon, and they're all calling tonight.
That's right. Seems like it. But now, this is very interesting. I don't know enough about this. I mean, I've seen pictures. I've heard we landed on the moon. They taught me that in school. So I had no reason to not believe it. But now I'm gonna go read some research.
You know what? This is a great song.
It is.
Because his name was Daniel.
Yes, I remember.
Hold on.
Daniel, you're a star.
And you love Daniel because he just gave you a good argument for why we did not land on
He's
the moon.
He's a brilliant man.
He's a brilliant man in your eyes. Yeah. I see that. Okay. Hi, Chuck.
How's it going?
Now, Chuck, no matter how much evidence there is, I don't believe in Bigfoot. I don't.
I don't know that I'm convinced.
But tell me why.
There's a lot of debate on both sides, but one of the biggest supporters a lot of folks may not know is Jane Goodall. She is actually a believer.
Really?
Yes.
I love her.
And there are a number of reasons that people feel it's possible, and one is just the amount of statistical data. If you're just a statistician and you pull the data, there's a lot of consistency as to when and where there are reports. And there are a number of items of physical evidence that are very difficult to just explain away.
No, I just needed to know that Jane Goodall believes it. I'm in. I love her. I figure if she says something exists, she's a scientist, she does the research, I'm with her.
Mm-hmm. See?
See, if she says, yeah.
Well, there's actually a film from the 60s that a lot of people have seen and that a lot of people have dismissed it as a man in a suit.
Mm-hmm.
But most experts will tell you they can't explain the film. That it was, and they've tried to repeat it a number of times and can't do it.
How come they've never found a dead one?
Well, it's the same thing. Of a proponent, but when you think about it, how many dead nocturnal animals have you found? How many times
they get eaten by other stuff?
See, he's got a point.
Oh, there'd be roadkill.
A
Bigfoot?
Yeah, there's the people run into moose.
No, we're not saying that cars or trucks killed Bigfoot. He, died in the woods somewhere, and the bears ate him.
Yeah, somebody somewhere would have seen one big dead Bigfoot somewhere in the world
before they got him.
Bears and lions ate it.
There's new video on CNN I saw 2 days ago with a real Bigfoot,
mm-hmm.
and that was on CNN.
CNN
or
showed Bigfoot?
Yes, it was one of those channels.
I don't think it was CNN.
Could have been.
I think it was a sci-fi channel.
No, it wasn't. I saw it. It was a couple days ago.
Oh, well, if you saw it. See, I'm not so disturbed that people are calling and saying that they don't believe that we landed on the moon. I'm disturbed they're calling and agreeing with Anthony. That's really what's upsetting me tonight. Hi, David.
Hey, how are you?
Good. Now, what is something that you do not believe, no matter how much evidence people say there is?
Well, the thing about dinosaurs not existing, how absurd is that? has anybody never turned on to E and seen Joan Rivers? I don't understand.
Now that's the evidence.
That's vampires. That's not dinosaurs.
People keep chipping away at that fossil. But you can keep arguing about this thing about the moon all you want, but if we haven't been, we can go. All you got to do is just email Bush, let him know that there's weapons of mass destruction there. We're there. I mean, we're there. And, you know, Osama is in a moon crater, and if you just want to get to the bottom of it, put Cheney on the rocket. He'll shoot the pee out of everybody while he gets there, and we're done.
Okay, I'm emailing Bush right now.
Okay.
Send. Okay, we're going to be on the moon in, I don't know how long that takes. I don't know if he reads his own emails or not.
A few days.
Shannon, what is something you do not believe in, no matter how much people say it's true?
True love.
You don't believe in true love?
I do not, because people, they say they fall in love, they get married, and then they get divorced, and then they fall in love again and get married again and get divorced again. So as far as I'm concerned, everything is either lust or care, but I don't believe in true love.
Because if there was true, because it makes sense, if there was real true love, there wouldn't be so much divorce, because why would you divorce somebody if it was your true love?
Well, exactly, and then if it's your true love, how can you get married again?
Exactly.
Is this Cooper's husband, Sean Lee, disguising his voice?
Oh, you caught me.
Oh, sweetie, go make dinner. Yeah. That was great, Shannon. That was really funny. Hey, Derek.
Hello. How are you doing?
Now, you've got a couple of comments about some of the stuff we've been talking about that people do not believe in. What do you think?
Yeah, well, I'm not going to say that the landing on the moon didn't actually occur.
Mm-hmm.
George Bush, about 2 months ago, had a real strange quote where he said, "We hope to land on the moon by 2012. Why would you hope to do it if we did it 40 years ago?
That's interesting. Where'd you read that? That's really interesting.
USA Today.
Wow.
You believe in USA Today?
I don't believe in USA Today. That's the problem, Derek. Yeah.
And the other thing is, Osama bin Laden, in the comment that they made about Osama bin Laden, mm-hmm. if you go on FBI.gov and you look up Rex Toombs, he was a spokesman for the FBI, mm-hmm. he made a very valid point where he said, you will not see the 9/11 terrorist attacks on Osama bin Laden's most wanted page, because the FBI has no hard evidence linking Osama bin Laden to September 11th.
The only thing we have is his word, the tape that he made saying that he's responsible.
No, actually, they've proven that all of those tapes have been fake.
See?
Wow. Oh. This is really freaking me out.
Right, but...
And read the email you just got, Chad.
Chad, tell Anthony not to take any vaccines. The government is altering the serums to kill us early.
Can I read the one I got?
Yes.
Chad, are you really selling Duran Duran? Because I don't get
flu vaccines.
Because they're trying to kill you.
Exactly. Right. They're full of the flu. Every time you get one, you get sick.
I get a flu vaccine every year.
So you don't believe.
And you get sick.
Even though there's scientific evidence that flu vaccines work, you don't believe in them.
No, because every time I got one, I get sick. When I don't get one, I'm fine.
No, you don't get sick from the flu vaccine. I get the flu vaccine every year, and I never get sick.
Not going to tell me that.
Love my flu vaccine.
All I hear is blah, blah, blah.
You know me in medicine. Yeah, give it to me.
I hate shots.
Okay. Now, Crystal, what is something you do not believe, no matter how much people say that there's evidence and it's true?
I do not believe in fate, and I do not believe in miracles.
Wow, that's interesting. Because I feel like those two things are different. I feel like fate is something that just happens to you, whereas miracles is something that is, like a higher calling sort of thing.
No, well, I don't believe that there's anything such as like a miracle, because everything has a scientific reason behind it. We might not know what it is yet, mm-hmm. but everything has some scientific reasoning behind it.
So when something happens, you never go, it's a miracle or it's fate. There's always a good, solid explanation. Like, what kind of stuff?
Like someone who's mortally ill or something and they're supposed to die and then suddenly they just come back and they're 100%, I don't think that that's a miracle. There's some kind of scientific
reason. There's a medical explanation for it.
It's good medicine.
Because a lot of people believe that, quote, everything happens for a reason. That's fate.
Right. You know why they get better?
Right. Why?
Flu vaccine.
That's what I say. I take the vaccine every year.